that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. T'was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fear relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, ransom me, and like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. Sing that again, church. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. Listen to the words of this verse. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope, secures. He will my shield and portion be. As long as life endures, my chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace, unending love, amazing. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. Stuart, come up. I tell you, I just have to say this. It's like when the Horton clan enters the room, the worship is on. It's like Betty Sue has already primed it. It's ready, and here we go. Stuart, you ready, my brother?
Ready as a radio.
Let's do it.
Called to serve where others tried and failed, but with God's help and strength your efforts have prevailed. Touch not the glory, touch not the glory, touch not the glory, for it belongs to God. Have you some special gift, some riches you can share? Or are you called of God to intercessory prayer? Like she was, right? Touch not the glory. Touch not the glory, touch not the glory, for it belongs to God. Has God appointed you to some great noble cause that puts you where you hear the sound of men's applause. Touch not the glory. Touch not the glory. Touch not the glory, for it belongs to God. Weak and wounded sinner, lost and left to die. Oh, raise your head, for love is passing by. So come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus and live. Now your burden's lifted and carried far away, and precious blood has washed away the stain. So sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus, and live. Like a newborn baby, and remember when you walk, sometimes we fall. So fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus, and live. Sometimes the way is lonely and steep, filled with pain. So if your sky is dark and pours the rain, then cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus, and you live. Music fills the night, and when you can't contain your joy inside, then dance for Jesus, dance for Jesus, dance for Jesus, and live. And with your final heartbeat, kiss the world goodbye, and go in peace, and laugh on glory's side, and fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus, and live. Fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus, and live.
Brother, I love you. So good. I love you too, Aaron. Good to see you, brother.
Thank you.
Where do we go from here? Church, today we have indeed come for one reason, and that's to celebrate life, because that's what today is all about. In the midst of our grief, in the midst of the separation that we feel today, that brings tears for a very good reason. We also are filled with the hope That just a few days ago, we know what happened. She flew to Jesus. She's home. She's whole. She's well. I want you to know that as we come to celebrate Miss Betty Sue Horton's life, this is the truth. She died many, many years ago when she gave her heart to Christ as a young lady. And in that death, she found true life. And what this family wants for you, I know what Stuart wants for you, I know what everybody here today that's going to speak and celebrate and share life, what they want for all of us today is to be sure that we have a walk with Christ. Because the truth is, she's home. She's celebrating. If you said come back, she'd say no way. You come where I am. But I want to tell you, there's only one way to where she is. And that's through Jesus Christ. And this moment, it is for us today because we need healing. We need the Holy Spirit's help. We need God to give us the peace that passes all understanding. And we need to begin that process of letting God mend our hearts after such a loss. But I'll tell you this. If you don't know Christ, this is what today is truly all about. And we're not going to touch the glory today. Because I'm going to tell you what, if we did, Miss Betty Sue would be hunting me down as soon as I get to heaven, wanting to know why we did such a thing. But I'm going to tell you, it's hard to not celebrate a life well lived. Amen. So we're going to ride that balance today of being sure that we understand that everything that she is, everything that she was, everything that she will be, it's because of Jesus. Amen. She's laying down some crowns. Amen? Yes. But here's the truth. We have a lot of reasons to say thank you to Jesus today. And so we worship today. This isn't, listen, I don't know how many funerals you go to. They may feel very much like they're anything but worship. This is going to be worship today because I know the heart of this family. You've already seen in just a few minutes, they want to celebrate the life that she lived. And let me tell you why we can do that today. Out of the book of Proverbs chapter 31, I just want to read you a few verses. As I read them the other night, I just thought so much of her. Listen to these words. Strength and dignity are her clothing. She smiles at the future. She opens her mouth in wisdom. And the teaching of kindness is always on her tongue. She looks well to the ways of her household. She doesn't eat the bread of idleness. Her children, they rise up and they call her blessed. Her husband also, he praises her, saying, many daughters have done nobly, but you excel them all. Charm is deceitful, beauty is vain, but a woman who fears the Lord, she shall be praised. Give her the product of her hands, and let her works praise her in the gates. We're going to honor that today. And so as her son comes and speaks in a few minutes, as her grandson comes and speaks in a few minutes, I want you to hear and listen to what made this lady so special. His name is Jesus. And it's made a difference in eternity for this church, a difference in eternity for so many of you sitting in these rows. One thing I know about this lady is if you were her friend, you were her family. And every time I went to that house, I felt nothing but being like family. And I believe that is true of so many of you. That's why we're here. That's why we celebrate. And I know this family wants to extend thanks to you. For all the gifts of love, the gifts of cards, the gifts of phone calls, the gifts of food that they've received in the past few weeks, I know that they are forever grateful, but mostly they're grateful that you came here today to celebrate with them the life of Miss Betty Sue. Let's pray together. Father, we are indeed grateful, Lord. What a beginning to what is going to be a wonderful service. So, Lord, we praise you. We worship you. We give you thanks today for a life well lived. And Heavenly Father, as this family comes to share her life, God, may you just give them the words to speak, Lord. May it come back, Lord, not from their memory, but from their heart today, the things that they want to share with all of us. And Father, we are grateful that today we know that she is with you in heaven. And Lord, that today we find healing and help in the reading of the Word of God. Lord, we find healing and help in the presence and person of Christ. And Lord Jesus, may you speak to us in this moment. May your spirit convict. And if there's just one soul that needs salvation, God, may today be that day of salvation. Lord, open up hearts, open up minds, and Lord, allow us to hear the truth from your word that you want to share with us today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine, yeah. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Sing hallelujah. Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. I can only imagine when all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine.
We can only imagine because we can see through a veil darkly right now. But the promise comes, peace I leave with you. My peace I give, not as the world gives to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, let neither be afraid. We confess so often that peace, that faith in the songs we sing. Congregation, would you stand and let's sing this great hymn of comfort and affirmation in our lives. With Seated. So I knew that Betty Sue loved music, and it came that Betty Sue loves a quartet. So there went some phone calls. Hey guys, can we put a song together? Y'all are up now. I'm sorry. Oh, I'm sorry. It's eulogies. I'm sorry. I don't have my order. I'm sorry.
Need to. Brother Lee, you come on. They're going to have a quartet here soon.
We're going to have a quartet.
So Lee and Justin, are you going first, Justin?
I'm going first.
You go first, my brother. All right, love you. All right.
I'm not in a quartet. So.
Come on, I'll put you up here, brother.
I'll get up here with you.
I'll get you up here.
We could do it. We could do it, I guess. Well, it's good to see everybody. Thank you for being here. Obviously, it's a difficult situation, but I know we're somewhat excited. Right, for where she is, yeah. I'm not used to talking with microphones. I'm a college football coach, so I yell a lot. So if I step away and get excited, just forgive me. My name is Justin. I'm the oldest grandson, and I've been given the monumental task of talking on behalf of the 9 grandkids and 4 great-grandkids, 2 on the way. 1 in June, 1 in July. So I'm super excited about it. We all got together and talked about our memories. And there's a ton of memories. We could talk forever about memories. But there's a couple other things I want to talk about as well. But the first thing for me, my memory, I'm a little spoiled because I was given the opportunity to live with her since I was in the 2nd grade. Not everybody gets to experience that, and if you've experienced that here, living with your grandparents, and a grandparent that you love dearly and that you cared about, it's life-changing. It's life-changing. So to the rest of you grandkids, I'm sorry. All right, I got a lot of goods. You guys have a lot of good memories, too, but I got the best of it, and that's a gift that God gave me that I'm super grateful for. But the best memory I have, and everybody in here will have this, we're a sports-oriented family. If you know us, we love our sports, right? Football, basketball, whatever it may be. And I think I get my loudness and my intenseness from her when we used to watch the Carolina basketball games or the Wake Forest basketball games, and she'd yell at the TV. If it was going good, if it was going bad, it didn't matter. She'd yell at it. And she's the only person I know that could have two teams, right? She had two teams. She had Carolina. She loved Carolina, but she went to Wake Forest, so she loved Wake Forest as well. And it was always funny, right, when Chapel Hill was playing Wake Forest, who'd you pull for? And she didn't have to make that choice. That was her prerogative. And, you know, I hope that God has forgiven her for her years of yelling for the Tar Heels. I don't know. I'm just glad, Rob and Dad, we got red flowers, right? That's something that we at least got that. But I think God's grace is good, so I think he had enough left. He had enough left for that. But we have so many memories. I'm grateful for our memories. Tanner was talking to us about his biggest memory, taking a bath in Grand Sink. All right, and I think everybody in our family has taken a bath in that sink, and some of you who are not even a part of the family possibly have taken a bath in that sink as well. We saw a picture yesterday of Kristen in the original sink from before we, I don't even know where you are, but from before we, there you are, from before we remodeled. Hunter remembers Grant teaching her how to knit. That was one of the things she loved, right? Going to your games and knitting, and that's one of the things she loved, and cooking. That's one of the central themes, right? She loved food. She loved to cook. She loved to eat, right? And that was one of the great things. And there's a picture of Hunter and Gran that's on our refrigerator. And it's sort of a famous picture. Now that I have kids, I really get this. I think you were at that age where you're probably my Sophia's four, where she's just big enough that she can do stuff, but she's just old enough where she can destroy things. Right, and you guys are making sausage balls. That's one of your greatest memories. And it's she's leaned over and she's doing it, and Hunter, she's teaching her. And, you know, Hunter's probably doing a good job, but at the same time, every other one, she's probably smashing it and making a mess. And the patience, right? That's one of her greatest virtues was patience. And she had patience with you to do that. But back to the food. Davis and Daniel remember going to Gran's house on Friday nights and having dinner with her. Any sort of fried chicken, she was in, right? Didn't matter, Bojangles, Smithfield's. If you remember the Country Kitchen in Zebulon, that was a good one. Her and I would go every Wednesday, fried chicken, macaroni and cheese, stewed apples. That's what it was, right? So that's a great memory that you all have. And Kristen said this morning, which I forget about sometimes, when you guys would come in. Chris and Joshua lived in Charlotte, so they were here on holidays, and just walking in the door and that smell, right? When she'd been in the kitchen, and many of you were in her Sunday school class for Christmas parties, and she'd come in and she'd cook, and she taught me how to cook, so that's a great memory that I have. And she made us all grandkids. She made all of us feel like what she was doing with us, we were the most important. At that moment, right? If it was, and for you, you were telling me about this, Joshua. You wanted jelly. He loved jelly, right? And she made this. She could make it from scratch. And you'd ask her every Thanksgiving, can I have some jelly? Can I have some jelly? And she'd go out of her way to make sure that you had that. But there's so many memories, but I don't want to miss the biggest thing about her. We all have the memories, but it's more than memories. She had an impact on every person in this room. I think everybody would agree with that. Some way, shape, or form, she affected your life and how you lived your life after you came in contact with her. So I got to thinking, I got to praying, I said, all right, God, what can I say about such a wonderful person? Like, what do you say? Right? We could be here for hours. So I thought about it. And the one thing as grandkids that our memories revolve around is her doing something for us. So I came up with this word. And I talk to my players about this all the time because I want them to understand it. And I think it's she lived this on a daily basis. And that word is sacrifice. Sacrifice. She lived sacrifice. And to me, the definition of sacrifice is giving until it hurts. It's giving until it hurts. There's no such thing as a sacrifice if you're not giving until it hurts. Right? You may give up some things, but if it doesn't hurt, it's not truly a sacrifice. And she lived a life of sacrifice. And when I say this, I don't mean later in her life when she couldn't do things for herself, but when she could do things for herself and she could go to games and all this stuff. I never saw Gran sick. I never saw her sick. She never told me, she never told me I can't go to your game. She never told Lee, I can't take you to practice. I can't go to your game. When Josh was playing in Raleigh at the Ravenscroft tournament, it wasn't, I can't go because I have something else to do. When Tanner and Baker and Davis and whoever had events, games, Kristen had games, she was there. There was never a no. When there was dance recitals, you're the only one, right? She was at every single one in the front row. And she would sit through all 8 hours of it. Or whatever it was, sorry. And just happy, happy about it, right? And she loved it. But she never would say no. And that's what sacrifice is. It's giving and giving and giving until it hurts. Life wasn't easy for her. It wasn't always what it seems on the outside. She went through things, difficult things, but there was never a no. And I would think everybody in this room, even if you're not family, she did something for you. Even if you didn't deserve it, even if she didn't really want to on the inside, she did it. And I sort of want to finish with this. I don't want us to miss how much she sacrificed, and I don't want us to miss who she was. The reason is grandkids, that we got to experience what that was, and the reason that we got to see that, not only was it because of her, but it was because that she lived that for her own children. She lived that on a daily basis for her own kids. And because she did that, her kids, who are our parents, now do that for us. There's never a no with our parents. My parents come to Tennessee to bring Ella because Gran did for her. Every one of our aunts and uncle would move heaven and earth for us because of the example that she set. So my charge, I guess, to the rest of the grandchildren is this. Don't miss that she sacrificed for you. Because you're going to be husbands. You're already a wife. You're going to have kids. Right? And you're going to be able to impact them because of the way that she impacted you. So teach your kids. Teach your kids what she did for you. And make that name her name. And Baker, you got the most important job because you're named after her. You ain't got a choice. So make it live on. And the reason, like you were saying, that she could do that, I'm sorry, I'm talking, I'm getting excited. I'll get off, I promise. But the reason that she could do that was because of Jesus. It was because of Jesus. And I'll finish with this. And I found this verse, and I think this is her. 1 John 3:16, it says, by this we know love, because he laid down his life for us, and we also ought to lay down our lives for our brethren. She laid her life down. But whosoever has this world's goods and sees his brother in need and shuts up his heart from him, how does the love of God abide in him? My little children, let us not love in word or in tongue, but in deed and in truth. I love grand like everybody in here. And I am eternally grateful for her. As you all know, I was adopted. And I truly believe, I truly believe that God brought me here to her. And that God brought her to me. Because he knew what I needed. And he knows what we all need. So I'm going to pray, as I think I ought to. And then Lee's going to come up. Dear God, we thank you for Gran. We thank you for allowing us to experience her. We thank you that she loved you more than she loved herself, and that she loved you more than anyone else. I thank you that she lived her life on a daily basis, preaching the gospel and using words when necessary. We thank you for her. In your name, amen.
You should have went first. Just saying.
I made a big mistake. Oh, and I'm supposed to be all about tactics. I'm a coach. I didn't want to go after Ginger and Christy and Hunter. And now I really screwed up going after Justin. But before I get started, I am going to make one correction. When we were sitting together talking the other night about the service, we were talking about the flowers. They said, Kristen, you be in charge of the flowers, what we want to have. And what I remember her saying was, I don't know anything that much about flowers, but I just want blue. And we didn't get blue. Okay, Justin, they were supposed to be blue. That's exactly Carolina blue. I don't have to say that. It's just accepted. We're here to celebrate the life of one of the greatest women to ever walk this earth, Betty Sue Baker Horton, or more affectionately, Mama Bear. Our family wants to thank you for being here. And your presence is a testimony to her. Stuart, I can't thank you enough. Boy, Mama, she was crying in heaven. I mean, she's happy. She's happy up there, but I can promise you that brought her to tears. Oh, my God. Happy tears. Happy tears, man. I'm going to tell you, you can't listen to that and just not be moved, and you will never know how much that means to every one of us. I want to read a couple of verses here at the beginning. And I tell you, I'm lucky I pulled out the right paper. Justin was cleaning out the closet last night with pictures and letters that we wrote to Mom and everything, and he found the sermon that I preached for Youth Sunday right over here in the old chapel. And I said, oh, my gosh. You know, and there's so much about Mama. We almost put in the notice for you to bring your sleeping bags. I'm sorry. You know, Justin, you think you had something to say. Wow. I'm first going to read from John 14, 1 through 3. And I tell you what, I'm not going to read it if I don't put my glasses on. Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God. Believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you? I'll come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. you know the way to the place where I am going. Mother knew the way. She knew Jesus. 1 John 4:19 through 21. We love because he first loved us. Whoever claims to love God yet hates a brother or sister is a liar. For whoever does not love their brother and sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. And he has given us this command. Anyone who loves God must also love their brother and sister. Mother loved. She loved like no one else has ever loved. To me, that's the word that describes her, is love. And Jesus, a woman who loved Jesus, but loved everybody. You know, boy, it's really tough in COVID right now. And sometimes even in the way the times have changed as a coach, it's tough to hug a player. But I'm a hugging person because my mama was a hugging woman. And everybody wanted to hug her. And she wanted to hug everybody else. Because it's just how she showed her love. One of the many ways. A year and a half ago, Mother had had a couple of falls and she was in the hospital and she wasn't doing well. And the doctors told her, your mom's got about 2 weeks left. And Mom kept looking at us and she said, I want to go home. So we told the doctors, we said, okay. We just want her to be at home. Can we take her home and let hospice come and take care of us? We want her at home. And they said yes. We took her home, and hospice started doing their job. And I don't know how long it was, a month or, Terry could tell you, but the hospice lady looked at Terry one day and said, you don't need me anymore. Your mom ain't dying. She came home to that house, and with the love and the care of her family, she got better. And she had another year and a half of life to bless us. But I want to tell you that in that year and a half, I saw the impact of Mom on her children like you can't imagine. And I say we, but I really should say they in terms of my five sisters because I'm in Charlotte. But we gave her 24-hour care, taking turns. I would come on a weekend a month and do the whole weekend to just try to relieve them a little bit. But you know what? That was not a burden to me. Terry would always say, Lee, I cannot thank you enough for being here. I said, Terry, you don't have to. It was so good to be here with Mom and to be in this house. Six children taking turns. We did FaceTime calls every night for 2 hours to try to help and just to be with her. And sometimes got where we felt like it was even more of a burden than a joy because it became hard for her to concentrate and to talk and all that. But we did it because of our love for her. Why would people do this? Because of a mom that had loved them so much, like Justin was talking about, and went to everything we did with a smile. One of my teammates from Ravenscroft, he said, Lee, all I remember about your mom is she was always smiling and laughing. She was always smiling and laughing. And I especially, during that time, I'd be crazy not to say, I got a special thanks to Terry and Tim. You too, Tim. What you guys did for Mom. That's all I wanted from the time that you guys moved in that house was for Mom to know that Mom was going to be able to be at home until she died and be taken care of. And she got that. And it is a gift beyond all gifts. I mean, it has been amazing. And again, why would we do this? Mother went to, well, when we were little. You know, I won't talk that much on when we were little, but I mean, she cooked all the time for us. She took care of our needs. I mean, there was nothing that we ever needed that she didn't take care of. Fast forward, I'm at Ravenscroft going to school. She would drive to Ravenscroft 3 times a day. She would take us to school in the morning. She would come at the end of school to take the girls home and turn around and drive back to pick me up after my practice. 3 times a day, she would drive to Raleigh and never complain about it. Not, you know, you would never feel like, oh gosh, we're upsetting her because she's got to come. She loved taking care of her children. So she was at all our practices, our games. Justin alluded to this, the recitals, dance recitals, piano lessons, organ lessons, back and forth in Raleigh. She took us. Performances, plays, talent shows. She never missed anything. Every one of us. Every one of us were in something, and she would never miss. She was a good daughter. She was a good sibling. She was a good wife. She was a good friend. She was a good worker. And I'll go back to the days on the, you know, working on grandma and granddaddy's both the farms and raising and putting in tobacco. I'm going to tell you something. Nobody could throw tobacco on a stick. Now, before the machines came out, could throw tobacco on a stick faster than her and Aunt Marilyn. The two of them and all of us handing to her, we could put a barn of tobacco in a heartbeat. And then when the machines came, she was good at throwing it on that too. And she was smiling. And work. What a person to work beside. Are you kidding me? And then her job for Mr. Richard Murphy, who she loved dearly, as a secretary, Vaiden Whitley. When it was time to change that, he says, Betty, got to have you. We're doing East Wake now. Betty, we're going to do Sanderson. Okay, I'm right there. All right, now we got to start Leesville. I'm not doing it without you, Betty. I'm there. She was there. But you know what I loved? When I went to one of those schools, when I would come in town from Charlotte and I'd just stop by there to see her, seeing her sitting at the desk and seeing the kids migrate to her and hugging her and her hugging them. Oh, Miss Betty. Hey, Miss Betty. Early in the morning, I was there kind of early. School's already in and kids running in that were late for school. Oh, Miss Betty, I don't want to get in trouble. Can you cover for me? Can you get me in without being in trouble? Boy, did she take care of them. Lord, without one, she probably had to look around to see if Richard was looking. But, yeah, I got you. I got you. Don't worry about it, honey. She was a Sunday school teacher, choir member. She cooked for the church. She cooked for Heart to Heart. So she was all those things. But the best thing she was a mom. So I get the opportunity to share a few memories for my sisters and I. We'll start out with the youngest. Sorry, Christy. Christy was first. And Christy remembers Christmas Eves when Mom would sit up late at night on Christmas Eve and still be finishing up a stocking for a new member in the family. You know, whether it was a spouse or a new grandchild, whoever. I mean, Mom, they had to have a knitted stocking by Betty. How could you not? It had to go on the mantle. And, boy, she'd be right up there to the last minute. She'd finish that stocking, and there'd be candy in it the next day. There'd be something in it. Christy said, the most valuable lesson she taught me was beginning my day with time with the Lord. Amen, Christy. I always found her reading her Bible first thing in the morning when we were growing up. First thing, all the time. God says, give us your first fruits. Mama started her day with him. And that's why I do it to this day, because of her. What else would we give him other than our first fruits? Ginger, 43 years of recitals. And eight, was it only 8 hours, Justin? I could have swore it was longer than that sometimes. 43 years of recitals, but they were awesome, let me tell you. They're good. But nobody dances better than Ginger and Christy and Hunter, I'm going to tell you. They teach them, but they can do it the best. Mama would be on the front row, front and center, smiling every time we danced, Ginger said. Mom taught me how to extend the forgiveness Christ gave to us to others along my way. What a gift. What a gift. And of course, the older children, we were talking last night, you know, Mom could be stern if she needed to be. I mean, when does a parent not have to be stern sometimes? Except when you've had, I'm going to get my numbers right, 4 already, and you end up with twins at the end. There were no rules once the twins came. The twins could do no wrong. Yes, Ginger. Yes, Christy. Whatever you want, honey. The twins could do no wrong. Tracy. Now, I want you to listen to this. Tracy. Tracy said, Mom grilled me a steak and a baked potato before every game. Well, I'm jealous because she didn't do that for me. She brought me breakfast in bed after every game. She said, I remember Lee and I sneaking into the kitchen when Mom would be cooking a pound cake, and we'd pull it out early because we liked it when it was moist in the middle and it wasn't cooked all the way yet. And we'd scoop some out and push it back in. And she'd pretend like she didn't know we did it. But she also sometimes would take it out early for herself just to let us do it. Here, I pulled it out early. You don't have to do it behind my back. But we loved those pound cakes, man. Nobody could cook like her. Boy, everybody in Hephzibah used to want her pineapple cake or German chocolate cake. I mean, wow, she was something in that kitchen. That kitchen is just an incredible place to be. You walk in there, and it is just a place of love. As a pact, we always, one thing I love that Terry and Jim did when they got there was take that wall out and just make it bigger. But it's just a place of joy to hear. That's the thing, when I think of home and I think of Mom, I think of the noise in the kitchen and just people in there and you know, just being with each other, fellowshipping around food and just being together. There's nothing like it. One thing Tracy also added was that Mom always had faith in me. She told me that I could do and be whatever I wanted to be, and then she would back me up, and she would support me whatever I wanted to do. She's been that way with all of us, Tracy. Ellen loved taking Mama to the beach with her cat, Percy. And Mom, her and Mom would commune there with God and all his wonderful creation. Mom would talk about anything and everything she did so much with love at the beach. She loved the beach. I mean, I remember most of the childhood, our weeks at Topsail Beach, man. I loved our week with the whole family at Topsail Beach. And then Ellen got to help extend that with her place down there and sharing it with all of us. And Mom did so much love to go there. I won't ever forget her for all the things I've mentioned already about all my games and stuff. I appreciate her guidance. I remember one time that I was so upset about a situation, and boy, I wanted to get after somebody and write them, and I wanted to write them in the wrong way. I was a teenager, and I was mad. We were sitting on the swing in the backyard, swinging, and she looked at me and she said, Lee, you're not going to do that. She says, you're going to do it the right way. You're going to do it how God would want you to do it, the Christian way. And when she looked at you and told you that, then you believed it and you did it. There's nothing more important to me about Mom than her love for Jesus. She shared that with each and every one of us. Growing up in this church, Hephzibah, I mean, that's because of her. She had us in church on Sunday. And when you were little, that wasn't always what you wanted to do. But it's what you learned. That's what you're supposed to do. And then it became where you wanted to. If you don't have that right direction from your parents to start with, then it doesn't happen. I am going to get a little bit technical because I put Terry's on my phone. Now if I can find it. I learned so many things about Mom over the many years we shared. I learned how to live through adversity and difficult days, showing grace and always wearing a smile, even if there were a few tears. I learned much about opening our home and making it a haven for anyone who was in it. Groups of any size, from 1 to 45. Literally, you can set up tables in the bedroom and eat. You know, ever what we got to do to take care of everybody, that's what we'll do. There ain't a group too big. Oop. The key was just being together. Whether it was family, which kept getting bigger and bigger, or a Sunday school class. I learned to keep the table set with dishes all the time, so we were always ready to sit down and eat. Keeping fresh flowers out of the yard, though she didn't necessarily want to make it happen in the yard. Mom and I shared a lot. Good days and difficult days, but she always made the days better. In the end, we had a lot of routines and things we did just to make the day easier for her. But there is one that meant the world to me, and maybe to her. I would get her in bed, all comfy and snuggly, and as I walked out the door, I would look back and say, "See you in the morning, Glory." She was one of a kind. Thank you for being here to celebrate her today. We're so excited that she's with Jesus. And there's nothing we'd love more than for you to be that way too. I hope you are. Mom, see you in the morning, Glory.
Well, in honor of Betty Sue, a little four-part harmony.
Some bright morning when this life is o'er, I'll fly away to that home on God's celestial shore. By and by, I'll fly away. deeper in.
Thank you guys for being here today, and not just the people in this room, but also to everybody I know watching online. Graham is such a special person that even people far away who can't be here were asking how they could watch, and so that's just the kind of person that she is. I'm going to read a few Bible verses and just a little tidbit about Graham. So from 2 Timothy 4, 6 through 8, it says, "For I am ready, already being poured out like a drink offering, and the time for my departure is near. I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing." The Bible says that the day of death is better than the day of birth. Grant has already had her crown in heaven. She certainly kept the faith, and she fought the good fight. To tell Grant's story is to tell of Jesus. Even having the privilege to know Grant and to be around here is experiencing God. What a great role model she was, and what a great family she has left behind. Luke 2:29 says, "Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you may now dismiss your servant in peace." We love you, Grant.
Before I pray, I want to share something about this wonderful woman named Betty Sue Horton. I went to her one day along with Marilyn Allen, and I asked them, "Would you help me out at Hephzibah? We need Wednesday night meals." Did we get Wednesday night meals? That was the way both those women loved God. With the talent that he gave them to take a piece of meat and feed 360 people. Along with all the other toppings, pies and cakes. Betty Sue loved Jesus. And folks, right now, Betty Sue's in Jesus' arms. No better place to be in the world. I learned a lot by watching her in that room. She loved doing things for the Lord. When you're in love with Jesus, you got it made. And I'm in love with Jesus. I pray you are too. For he makes all the difference in the world. So Marilyn and Betty Sue said, "We'll cook on Wednesday nights." were they good cooks? Yes, they were. But they did it not for me, but for him. Choose you this day whom you will serve. But for me and my house, they said, we will serve the Lord. Pray with me. Our Father, you have taken from us one of your special, special servants. And yet, we will see her again. The vacancy that's there because of her homegoing, Lord, you will fill with your love. Bless the family of Betty Sue's. May they look to you, the author and finisher of our faith, day by day, as I have lost my parents, it will get more to say, well done, Lord. You don't make mistakes. We praise you, Father, for redeeming us, for calling us, for letting us represent you before others. Bless this family as they readjust from the absence of such a saint as Betty Sue was, always ready to serve you, Lord, at your beck and call. We pray this in Jesus' name and thank you. Amen.
For he is your guide. Be strong.
And I want to set the record straight right off the bat. I never took a bath in the sink. That didn't happen for me. So I still can. Hey, now that you're the matriarch of the family, I'll be over on Tuesday in a swimsuit. So. And yeah. Pot, kettle. Woo. Let me tell you something. This is what makes this family, the love and the laughter. You know what I miss? Sitting around that lazy Susan with her. I didn't know what a lazy Susan was, just like when you talked about putting tobacco on a stick. I don't know what you're talking about. I didn't grow up around here. And I didn't know what a lazy Susan was until I sat down at your table. And what I used to love about sitting around your table was the fact that no matter if it was a staff meeting, it didn't matter who was there, whether it was a supper club, she was always right in the middle there with us. And you know what I loved watching with her? And also the times when the grandkids were there. I remember one time getting to come over around Christmas and just the joy of those moments that I had with your family. What I loved was that she would just watch you. I don't know if you realize she did that. But as you spoke and as you laughed and as you celebrated life, I would just watch her as she just watched all of you. And I can't tell you the contentment that I saw on her face. I want you to know how proud she was of all of you, her children, all of you, her grandchildren. When I had the moments with her to speak with her, it was you that she wanted to talk about. It was you that she wanted to celebrate. And it was always about Jesus. My relationship with her consisted of basically what I loved about the most with her was she would call me her preaching fool. Sometimes I wasn't sure. I always heard the preaching on, you know, before the fool part. But you know what? She was one of my biggest encouragers. Even though when I would get up here and preach in jeans, she'd sit back there and say, "Christy, Ginger, is he back there in jeans? Is he up there preaching in jeans again?" She never said it to me. Because what she said to me was encouragement. Because I can tell you this, I felt loved. And that's what we're going to miss from her. We're going to miss that laughter. We're going to miss that love. But I want to tell you this, it will live on in you. I hope that you'll take Justin's words, because Justin, those were wise words today. It doesn't have to go with her. What she gave to you is meant to be passed on. What she gave to you is meant to be given to others, not just in your family, but the people that you have allowed to become family. Because the gift that she's given is one that is meant to be passed on to another generation. I want to share to you just out of these words. When I thought about her, I thought Kristen's verse that she read was very appropriate for her life and very appropriate for what has been shared today, because when you look at these verses, it simply begins, "For I am already being poured out as a drink offering." There's one thing, as Justin shared, it was her sacrifice. It was her willingness to give. It was her willingness to put others first, and more importantly, to put the kingdom of God first. That's what she devoted her life to. It was to people. Most of us get sidetracked. We devote our lives to jobs. We devote our lives to things. We devote our lives to things that are temporal, but she understood the eternal. And what she poured her life out for were the things that mattered the most. And you see, today we get to recognize that she has just departed. I get to travel a lot, and what I love is going to the airport, and you sit down, and they tell you that your departure time has come. Listen, whenever I think about departing at an airport, I don't ever think about the end. Departure is what? That's just the beginning. I want you to know that we're celebrating the beginning of her life. This is the truth that needs to resonate with us today, is that the moment she closed her eyes in this life, and she heard Jesus say, "Not good night. Good morning. Good morning, Glory." You see, that's what it means to depart. She didn't die. Listen, death has been defeated. The grave cannot hold us down. But what we have in this moment is the recognition that she has departed to go and be with the Savior that loved her and gave himself for her, and the Savior that she loved so much. What we can be grateful for today is that we have an example of a person who went before us, that fought the good fight, that finished the race, a woman that kept the faith. I love verse 8 where it says, in the future there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness. I think if there was one thing Miss Betty Sue would want us to remember, one of the things, upon studying this verse, you almost don't realize it and you don't miss it unless you understand a little bit of the Greek language. And what is amazing to me is it says that in future there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness. Folks, I want you to know we're not righteous because of what we've done. We're righteous because of what Jesus Christ has done. That's the gospel. I can do nothing to earn salvation except receive it. I can do nothing to earn God's favor except to just place my faith in the finished work of Christ upon the cross. And when we one day, as she has been, clothed in righteousness. The Bible says that we'll be clothed in life. We will be clothed in glory. I want you to know that every one of those things has nothing to do with us. It has everything to do with Jesus. And one of the things I think about when I read that verse is what it meant for Paul to write those verses. It's the end of his life. You may not realize it, but the man Stephen, probably one of the greatest things that burdened Paul the rest of his life was the regret that he had for his persecution of the Church of Jesus Christ. If you remember, he spent many of his years living, believing he was zealous for God, however not realizing that he was persecuting God's people. One of the first places that we find in Scripture the mention of the Apostle Paul was at Stephen's stoning. I imagine that stuck with him. If you ever saw the movie Paul the Apostle, you ought to watch it. It really, I think, gives a great portrayal, maybe of what was even the thorn in the flesh for the Apostle Paul, this understanding of those times. He said, I'm the chief of sinners. He could think of nothing worse than what he did to persecute the Lord's church, and he was right there as Stephen was martyred. He heard the words of Stephen as he looked to the heavens and said, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. You want to know what the word crown means in the Greek? The name Stephen means in the Greek? It means crown. Stephanos. I always wondered when he wrote down these words that I have been crowned with righteousness. Did he think of Stephen? Did he think about the fact that, you know what, if it wasn't for God, what would I be? If it wasn't for Christ, if it wasn't for salvation, if it wasn't for what Christ did for me, what righteousness would I have? When God found me, I was the persecutor. When God found me, I was the one martyring the Christians. When God found me, I was far from Him. And all he could probably see, and I'm sure it burdened him for many years of his life, was the things that he had done. But you know, I believe he came to the realization at the end of his life that Christ has covered all of that. And all he could think about was a crown. Let me tell you what Miss Betty Sue would say to you today. It's not me, it's Christ. You see, from the beginning of the service when Stephen sang, Stuart. Stephen, you're next. Get up here. When Stuart sang this morning or this afternoon, I want you to remember that he said, don't touch the glory. I want you to remember that everybody that has stood up here and spoken about Miss Betty Sue, they have said, you know what? It's Christ in her. Where did this love come from? Christ loved her first. That love changed her life, and now she has this capacity to love. Where does this service come from? From a desire to serve the one who came not to be served, but to serve. You see, she was a woman whose life was transformed by the power of the gospel. And I want you to always remember that, you know what? She's not crowned in righteousness because of a righteousness that she had. But she was crowned with righteousness because of a righteousness that is available to you. You can't earn it. You can't obey the law to deserve it. But what she would tell you today is, we serve a Savior. We have a God who sent His Son to pay the price for our sins. And folks, if you come to know Jesus, could you hear the conviction in Bill's voice? Could you hear the conviction in Stuart's song? Could you hear the conviction in Justin and Lee today? as they shared with you Christ, your need for Christ. You know why? Because Christ changes everything. And you know, the Word of God tells us how we can come into a relationship with Christ. I want you to see that this promise wasn't just for the Apostle Paul. It wasn't just for Betty Sue, but it says, in the future there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. And if it ended there, we'd have a very different outcome in the end of this meeting, because God doesn't end it there. Paul doesn't end it there. Listen to what he says. And not only to me, but also to all who love his appearing. You see, this gospel is for you as well. So family, thank you for letting this preaching fool be part of your life. I can't tell you what a blessing it is to think that, you know what, the connection, this is the deepness of it. You live in Charlotte, but I still get to do the marriage counseling for that beautiful daughter of yours. She taught us how to never say no. Let's keep walking, family. Let's keep serving, family. And as I close today, I'm going to ask Brother Rob Lee to come and share in this time of invitation. Family, you're loved. Come on, brother.
Love you. Thank you for being here from the bottom of my heart. And besides my mother and father, when I was 15 years old, I met Gran for the first time. And she loved me. And then when I was 16, 17, I started to show up at the house more and more and more. And she continued to love me. And I'd always thought in my mind that my future wife would probably be like her mother. And that's what I wanted. So as I saw that love transferred to Ginger, I wanted a wife who was going to be that, like her mom, like Gran, who loved her children, who loved her family. And so I experienced a godly love for the first time from Gran, other than my own parents. And it really made me wonder why. And what I came to find out, it was Jesus Christ. So this part of the service, I know there's some of you online, it is pretty unique to the Southern Baptist culture, is that we have an invitation. And this invitation is for you, your lost soul, to find love, peace, and joy in accepting the forgiveness and mercy of Jesus Christ. The invitation is for you to accept Christ and become a follower and a disciple of the one true God. You know, I started thinking about a legacy and what makes a legacy. So back in the day, we used to go to Webster's and look it up, which y'all know what we do now, we Google stuff. So I Googled what makes a person's legacy. And so according to Google, it says, when a person dies. So I guess our legacy starts when we die. According to Google, the mark the individual left on the world represent that individual's legacy. It is about the richness of the individual's life, including what that person accomplished and the impact he or she had on people and places. Ultimately, the story of a person's life reflects the individual's legacy. And you've been seeing us reflect on Gran's legacy today. Then I looked up the word eternal, and it's an adjective, according to Google, and it says lasting or existing forever, without end or beginning. So that's pretty cool. How can I put those together? And I said, well, I'll just look it up. So then I Googled the phrase godly eternal legacy. Man, that sounds good, doesn't it? Don't you want a godly eternal legacy? Guess what Google said? We don't know what that is. So the most powerful AI invention in the world doesn't know what a godly legacy is. Well, I don't know that I could put it in words, y'all. But I know what a picture of a godly legacy could be, and it could be that one right there besides those words. I might not know how to define it, but I know what it looks like. It was a woman who spent her entire life praying and singing the praises of God. And y'all, I don't mean just in church. I was around that house and in that kitchen a lot. There was always a lot of singing and praising and reading of God's word. A woman who read and followed the word of God consistently. She had six awesome, or has six awesome children which know, follow, and serve Christ. Has a beautiful daughter-in-law which knows, follows, and serves Christ. She's got three handsome son-in-laws that know, follow, and serve Christ. Got nine great-grandchildren which have accepted the free gift of salvation through Jesus Christ. She's got two great-grandchildren being brought up in the ways and teachings of the Lord, and she's got two more on the way. That legacy also includes hundreds of godly brothers and sisters in her church family. It includes the hundreds of men and women she taught Bible study to in the small group. Gran's great godly eternal legacy did not start with the day that she was born, but the day that she was reborn. Reborn with the Holy Spirit through the perfect sin offering of Jesus Christ. I'm telling you, if Gran was here today, she'd ask, what are you waiting for? With her big smile of encouragement, what are you waiting for to accept the King of Kings and Lord of Lords? And he says, as he says today, and I also know that she would ask you, what's more important than following Christ? So now is the time of the invitation, because the day is the day that the Lord has made. Today is the day of salvation, because the end as we know it is coming soon. He is coming back. So all believers here, all of you that know that you know that you know, will you bow your head right now? There's some of you still looking at me out there and looking at me online. And I want to ask you like Gran asked, what are you waiting on? What are you waiting on? I'm begging you, and the believers are praying for you, to just believe in Christ and let His Holy Spirit indwell your heart. He wants to begin a godly spiritual legacy in you today. He's ready. He's ready for you to quit running away from Him and run to Him. Let's all pray. Father, we're here and we are so grateful for the life of Betty Sue Horton. What a wonderful woman she was in you. A woman who showed the loving kindness and mercy and grace and compassion and acts of service, Lord, towards those she loved and those she didn't know. Would you help us carry on that legacy, Lord, of raising and teaching our children and our grandchildren and our church members and our family and those of the lost, God, that you are King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and that you bring hope that only you can provide. Again, we thank you for the life of Gran in the celebration that we were allowed to have here today. Gran, we miss you. But we know that you're in a much better place. All of God's children said.
Would you stand together as we depart this place? We want to worship the Lord together. To God be the glory. Great things He hath done. So loved He the world that He gave us His Son, who yielded His life. You take that praise, you're dismissed.
To the garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there.
God.